In this video, we'll be tackling adding the final paint for the eyes, as well as doing a render for our character. As certain surfaces have different lighting properties, for example, the eyeballs will have more of a shiny reflective surface in comparison to the body, we'll be filling the eyes with a separate material with these kinds of properties. For the base iris color, I'll choose something that will stand out in contrast to the body paint. And for the eyeball subtool, right now the resolution is too low to draw in clean PolyPaint. So let's undo that action and navigate to the DynaMesh options. Since we've appended these into our scene from the subtool palette, these are separate from our original DynaMesh project from Lightbox, therefore did not come preset with the DynaMesh settings enabled. Navigate to the DynaMesh settings and click on the DynaMesh button to enable it, and this will re-DynaMesh the surface. After reapplying the PolyPaint, if the resolution is still not high enough for clear PolyPaint resolution, let's adjust the resolution higher. So I'll turn on PolyFrame to view the topology to see the DynaMesh changes, and now press Control and drag on the canvas to re-DynaMesh. In this case, you can see nothing has happened. Once the DynaMesh mode has been enabled, in order for it to re-DynaMesh the surface when using Control and drag, it needs to see a sculptural change on the mesh. Since we've started the painting process and disabled the Z-Add feature while painting with our brushes, we aren't affecting the topology of the mesh. To fix this, we can use the Smooth Brush by pressing and holding Shift and re-enabling the Z-Add button, and now we can just smooth in some areas on the surface to apply a change in the topology. Now, Control drag on the canvas, and you can see that we can re-DynaMesh the surface. Continue to adjust the resolution until you get the paint resolution that you need, and be sure to disable the Z-Add feature for the Smooth Brush if you wish to continue smoothing the surfaces for PolyPaint without smoothing the sculpture details later in this process. After reapplying the PolyPaint again, this resolution is now giving me nice PolyPaint details. For more visible separation of these surfaces, let's find a new material for the eyes. Inside of the material palette, the toy plastic material here is an excellent material with a nice shiny reflective surface. By selecting this material, the eyes, as well as the body subtool, now have the toy plastic material properties showing on the surfaces. In order to work with separate materials on different subtools, just like the painting process, we need to fill each object with the base material of our choice. At the top, we have other options next to RGB called mRGB and M. When filling objects with a base color, we've previously used the RGB option to fill with color. When M is selected, this means we'll be applying only material information to the surfaces and will not affect RGB or color information on the mesh. Let's first fill the body subtool with the skin shade material that we've been painting on so far. I'll make sure it's selected in the subtool palette and choose the skin shade material, and in the color palette, press Fill Object. Now, for the eyes, let's select them in the subtool palette and choose the toy plastic material. When using the mRGB option, we can apply both material and RGB information at the same time. For example, choosing a new color in the color palette, and with toy plastic selected, clicking Fill Object, we can fill with both options. Applying different materials on your objects will give you more controls for final render options in your scene. We can even select different colors and materials and use our painting brushes to apply both options directly onto the surface for an added level of painting controls. There are many painting applications with mRGB information, especially when surfaces have different lighting or material properties, and we recommend you visit Z Classroom to explore other videos that focus on these kinds of painting applications with mRGB. Moving forward, I'll choose a base color of white and reselect the toy plastic material and fill the eyes once more. With both subtools filled with a separate material, let's focus on finalizing the paint for the eyes and re-enable the RGB option to add the final poly paint. To paint in the iris, let's select an alpha that will help draw in those circle shapes. Choosing an alpha with less falloff will help more perfectly define the iris while using the drag rectangle stroke to add it. I'm going to choose alpha 14 by clicking on it, and I'll also change the stroke type to drag rectangle. We can draw this alpha with the drag rectangle stroke by clicking and dragging up and down to draw this alpha into place. When applying paint with an alpha to the mesh while using the drag rectangle stroke, there's a more apparent falloff of color around the edges. This is based on the focal shift setting of the brush. Currently, the focal shift is set to 0, and looking at the brush, we can see the falloff distance on the two circles of the brush. Adjusting the focal shift slider to minus 100 will remove that falloff, and applying the paint to the surface will apply the entire alpha shape with color without that falloff. Using the same techniques, we can fill in the area for the pupil with black poly paint and continue to paint as needed. If you'd like to spend more time on the surfaces of your character, I recommend you continue to experiment with different stroke and alpha applications on the surface. For example, if we switch to alpha 58 and switch to a brighter, more visible color, we can start to add in more detailed lines for the iris, or change our alpha and stroke and paint over these areas by hand. There are many possible combinations we can come up with to find the PolyPaint controls for your needs, so continue to experiment with these as you progress. When you've completed sculpting and painting the character, we can quickly create a ZBrush render and export out our image. First, position your model on the canvas by rotating around to a nice 3/4 angle. If you find yourself scaling away from the mesh while working, we can bring the mesh to full frame on the canvas by clicking the frame button here or pressing the F key on the keyboard. To render the scene, press the BPR or Best Preview Render button located here. If you're a hotkey junkie, the keyboard shortcut to do a BPR render is Shift R. This will render the entire scene and apply shadows to the character. To change the background or document color, navigate to the Document palette, and here we have the Background Color option. Clicking once will set the background color to the main color selection here. Adjusting the main color to a proper background color of your choice, and click again on the Background Color button in the Document palette. To adjust the gradient falloff, we can adjust the Range, Center, and Rate sliders to get the background look of your choice. While rendering or using multiple menu options, as we are starting to do, it can be helpful to make use of the entire ZBrush UI and use the trays. There is a second tray here on the left that we can click open and position some of these palettes for easy access. To position a palette in the tray, let's open up the Document palette, for example, and we can put this within either of the trays by clicking this icon at the top, which will automatically drop it into one of our trays, or we can click that open again and instead click and drag this to the tray of your choice. We can fit multiple palettes into the same tray or position them on both sides for easy access. Let's do another render by pressing the BPR button or Shift R on the keyboard. The floor represents the ground where shadows will cast at render time based on our light position. If you want to cast floor shadows at render time, make sure that the floor is enabled by clicking the floor grid button here. To adjust the shadows with the light placement on the character, navigate to the light palette, and at the top, we have a light that we can adjust. Click and drag on the light placement icon, and it will update on the scene. We can also adjust the intensity of this light by adjusting the intensity slider. Once you found a placement that works for you, press the BPR button again to apply another render. With the light in a new place, the shadows are casting further on the floor grid. The clipping that's happening here is caused by the floor grid being too small. Navigating around the scene will clear the render, and let's scale up the floor grid. To scale the floor grid, navigate to the Draw palette, and here in the Floor Grid options, there's a slider to adjust the grid size. Click and drag to make this larger, and let's do another render. When we've landed on a render that looks good, we can now export the render as a final image. To export the image, open up the document palette and click the export button. This will give me different image options to export. Exporting out as a JPEG will give you a separate option to crop and adjust the image. We can crop the image by clicking and navigating around the preview image and dragging the red icons in all four corners of the image. Or we can use the cropping sliders here to adjust the overall height and width of the image. Enabling the Adjust button will open up further controls to adjust the image to a desired final look. And when completed, press OK to export the final image. That wraps up this entire series on the basics of sculpting and painting a character in ZBrush. At the end of this process, I've taken Sharkboy even further by posing the body and adding extra elements for a full scene. Many of these accessories were created by using other basic features in ZBrush, as well as the ZModeler brush to create the bucket that has the oil spilling out, the shovel on his back, and also the fanny pack, which always comes in handy. You can look forward to finding new creative ways to make art with ZBrush by visiting ZClassroom to explore other videos that will discuss how to create these kinds of objects and properly render your scene. If you find yourself in need of further explanation of certain features or techniques, be sure to follow us on Twitter, where you can send us direct ZBrush-related questions and have it answered in our Ask ZBrush section on our YouTube channel. Thanks for visiting ZClassroom, and happy ZBrushing!